you might understand, you might think, well, why study ice? Why are we going to ice cores? And so, like many other archives, natural archives that are out there, there is the idea that we're trying to develop a history or a record, a proxy record of something in the past. And so you can imagine where the snow is piling up and we're building up a year, year by year by year, we're building up a layer cake, effectively, of history. And then we come along and we drill an ice core through that, and effectively we're taking a sample or of that layer cake of history. And that history can go back, you know, a few decades, or that history can go back thousands or tens of thousands or even potentially up to a million years. Well, we got the lived of them. We got lots of rare earths. My name is Joe McConnell. I'm a research professor at DRI. So about 5 or 6 years ago, I was contacted by an archaeologist who studies the Neolithic, by the way, and an ancient historian who's an expert on the Roman period. And they had talked about trying to develop much more complete records of lead pollution, specifically during the Roman period, specifically to look at Roman history. That was kind of what started us down this road of looking at much further back in time and being really involved in history.
One thing we see in the ice is how devastating certain historical events like plagues or wars can be on economic output. And so in the ice, where we have these annually resolved records, we can see in the ice layers corresponding to a certain plague or a war, for example, the Antonine Plague, you get a huge drop in lead pollution immediately, suggesting really widespread catastrophe in these areas that are the source regions for the lead emissions. And so those really sharp drops associated with kind of calamitous events are one of the things that really stand out in these lead records we're looking at.
Ice cores provide this really ideal media or material to look in to find these human influences. For instance, wars. We see a result that you get higher lead pollution because of these wars, because there's more manufacturing, more creation of materials, more burning of these different lead ores, and really creating these different things.
2 or 3 years ago, we were able to identify a volcano that erupted in Alaska in 43 BCE or BC. This is the very end of the Roman Republic and the beginning of the Roman Empire. This is the time of Cleopatra and Egypt and Mark Antony and Octavian, who they became Caesar Augustus, and Julius Caesar and so forth. This is their period, exactly their period. And right in the middle of this transition, one of the largest eruptions of the last 2,500 years happened, and we were able to identify that as being in Alaska, in the Aleutian Chain in Alaska, a mountain called Okmok. And that, because we know where it is and we know its size, we were able to model its climate impacts. And so we were able to really get some very precise information on what of a major climate shock that hit the Mediterranean exactly during this transition. How much of an impact it had on that transition is, we can't say, because we're environmental scientists, climate scientists, looking 2,000 years back. However, these were agrarian societies that were constantly on the verge of famine. So you can imagine if you had this major climate shock that lasted 2 years with major cooling and lots of flooding and that sort of thing, you can imagine there was a pretty big impact on those agrarian societies. So undoubtedly, from my perspective, undoubtedly had an impact on the history.
Thank you.
goal was to get a 4,000-year-long ice core record to look at early Bronze Age pollution from metallurgy, so lead pollution from smelting, specifically lead pollution from smelting ores to extract metals from them.
When the plane flew away and I realized that I was gonna be in that spot on this ice sheet, not really knowing where I was for many weeks, I was like, oh.
I guess my most sensory experience or most memorable experience was when we were driving these trucks, these Arctic trucks, hundreds of miles. It really felt isolated and quiet and kind of eerie in a way, just thinking and realizing how small you are in the landscape and how much ice there is and how there's nothing for hundreds of miles, really, truly nothing.
We had a morning shift that was myself, a driller, Joe McConnell, and our resident historian, Brandon McDonald, who kind of worked together on this one shift, as well as our mechanic, Pat, who was there.
I did the night shift. So we started, I want to say it was like 3 p.m. to midnight. But the sun never goes down, so it didn't really matter. Like, you just kind of adjusted your day. So like midnight looked like noon. And so, I don't know, you're like, does this, time doesn't matter. You really mess with your head after a while out there. Or you're just like, this, I don't know, this isn't reality.
That drill is essentially drilling out a cylinder of ice for us. It's all attached to basically this big cord as it goes down into the ice. It drills down as it goes, and then you bring it back up.
Ice is under a lot of pressure at depth, and so it started getting really difficult to extract in good solid pieces because they would just pop and break. And so we would get like these pucks of pieces that would come up or just like shatter it altogether.
You know, that was kind of where we start to worry a little bit about, you know, can we get this done?
I'd say mood in camp was tense for a few days as we figured out our strategy. Yeah, it's really demoralizing to be spend so much time and effort to get out to Greenland and see how much effort we've put into getting out there and then having our ice cores come up as crumbly little hockey pucks or poker chips, they call them. So that was demoralizing.
Once it got so rough that we couldn't drill anymore, essentially, and so we moved and started to do a second core in another spot. And that core ended up being a lot better once we got down to even the same depth that we were getting really frustrated with the first core. It was still breaking up, but not as much to the extent as the first core. And so everyone was feeling better about that.
was salvageable, but yes, nonetheless, very frustrating.
Not as much success as we'd hoped for. Basically, the drilling was more difficult than we thought. And instead of getting one very long record, we brought back two records that go back, let's say, 1,500 to 2,500 years in each of them. We are in the process right now of analyzing those ice cores to see what we can see. And again, it's this is about, the primary focus is ancient history. So instead of having one very long record that goes back 6,000 years, now we have a second and third record that go back more like 2,000 years. So it's extremely valuable for understanding the history of so for instance, the shallower of the two cores that we collected goes back to the start of the European Middle Ages, about 600, AD 600, and extends up to the present. And so we'll have another record of that, and we're trying to really get high quality information from that period. Starting as a little boy and fascinated with the polar regions and to where I am now, sort of on the other side of career, it's been a pretty exciting run. And the idea that I would get to make many, many trips to the Arctic and the Antarctic and do the work that I get to do, it's been pretty good.